And we're off and running on our first ever simulcast here. Welcome to the Dharma King Apex Yoga Intensive 217, really pre-intensive. 217 is a pre-intensive, so it gives everyone an opportunity to find their niche. I want everyone to find a niche in Apex Yoga. Okay, not everyone is going to be able to do the practice right away. You have to stay in the boat so you don't fall in the ocean. So it requires a lot to do this. And I'm working through it right now and experiencing it. So it's great. Now I'm doing a simulcast here, and I'm going to put this digital audio recorder. I'm going to upload this on SoundCloud. So then you can download it as an MP3 and listen to it whenever you want to listen to it. The only catch is I only have a certain amount of space on SoundCloud before they ask you for $150, which I don't have. So after 6 hours, that's it. So I have to delete some of the stuff that came before. So if you want to get on this right away when I get it up there and download it, if you want to listen on the go, you can put it, listen in your car, right, as you're driving. And the volume won't be very high. For some reason, the output volume of this is super low. I can't figure out why. So you might have to crank it up. I'm trying to speak as loud as possible without clipping. There might be some clipping. But that's because I'm trying to make the volume as much as possible to overcome this weird anomaly with this recorder. Anyway, this may help out some of you who might be on the go or not, you know, able to watch the videos as you're doing stuff. You can now listen to the audio, so we'll give it a try. And it's I'm having all sorts of wonderful ideas of like no-brainers, like why not do this. It's great, right, to have these no-brainers come to you and say, so simple, so obvious, just record simulcast here, simultaneously both, why not? It never occurred to me before. So this is good. When a lot of this starts happening, I'm doing great. Really, 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 really great. God said to me yesterday, how you doing? I said, well, I'm 99% ready. He said, okay, well, what about the 1%? So let's work on that 1%. And I said, oh boy. Yeah. So we've been working on that 1%. We started today. I'm starting to, the grace of God said, look, you got to start jogging. And working on quote-unquote your swimming. I said, but I don't have a pool. I said, you know what I mean. So I devised this exercise where I'm able to simulate the like a surfing paddling motion with using these rubber stretch bands over a beam, kind of a high beam, and I pull like this. And that seemed to work great. And then for running, I don't want to go out into the mountains and stuff. I always get sick when I do that for some reason. So I understood that I'm supposed to be running on a trampoline. So I have a trampoline here, and I just simulate jogging on a trampoline. And so far it worked great. We'll see how my knee holds up. It's the first try, 10-minute try. I'm just keeping my fingers crossed that my knee feels good in the morning. Because if it does, then wow, really getting things really dialed in here, which is great. Apex Yoga, it's really a pioneering approach. We're pioneering a new approach here. I've likened it to Japa Yoga or Mantra Yoga, but it's not the same. It's not exactly the same, really. It's close. It's just the emphasis a little different. In Japa or Mantra Yoga, they have it's the sounds, the syllables, the sounds, the divine name. Like Japa Mantra use like the divine name. And Mantra Yoga can use, Om Mani Padme Om or something like that. They're these syllables. Here, we're just using I am an apex yogin or I am an apex yogini. Wow. That's it. Wow. 360-degree wow. Full stop in the wow. And just use that. Very, very, very simple. I am a apex yogin wow. I am an apex yogin wow. I am an apex yogin wow. So you're repeating this or trying to repeat it, and you'll be amazed at what comes up in your mind, and you begin to watch the television of your mind. Watch the television of your mind. There's this inner television going on constantly, actually, and we're not even aware of it. The play of our mind is taking place constantly, but by doing this, you start to see what the play actually is because it keeps interfering with your practice. That's the amazing thing about it. And today was all this heroic stuff, like, oh, you're going to do so many great things, my mind started to be carried away about this story about, doing this, doing all this great stuff to help the world and heroic stuff, and I said, wait a minute, I'm supposed to be practicing. What's going on here? So no matter what arises, you're supposed to just stick with it. Stick with I am an apex yogin, or I am an apex yogini. Wow. Just stick with that. Very, very, very simple. We don't want to make it complex at this point in time, right now, quote unquote time. The way that the play of continuity fear or familiarity bias against certainty is playing out, the play of doubt, which is this conditioned existence, is the play of doubt. We're trying to doubt what we are. And doubt casts no shadow upon what we are at all. No shadow at all. So all this doubt is much ado about nothing, really, much ado about nothing. Now this comes to light with this practice. You start to see the play of the mind, really, really, really see the play of the mind. And you say, oh my gosh, this is going on all the time. This play of doubt, this very clever play of doubt that will try to seduce you away from what you really are and remain with doubting what you really are, even though it's very clever, like, well, you're going to do something great for the world. You're going to. And it comes up with all these scenarios. And then also, there's super negative stuff that comes up, really negative stuff. Last night, something came up. I started. Sometimes it happens immediately when I start the practice that something comes up right away, some resistance. And last night, it was this crazy reaction deep in the mind of this super violence. Just, like this raging violence. And I saw it all kind of like lightning across the sky. I said, wow, that's interesting. Okay, I am an apex yogin. Wow, I am an apex yogin. Wow, and just kept on practicing. But you realize the mind, what's going on, the content of the mind. Oh gosh, that's in there. It's in everyone. Everyone who is here in this world has these complexes in the mind as the play of doubt. It's the play of doubt. There's all this very, very strong, loaded content with fearful content and its expression. But you just stay in the boat. That's in the ocean. The ocean is churning and etc. But you're in this boat and you just stay relaxed. And I am an apex yogin. Wow. See, I deserve to be in this boat. The boat is the boat of reality. The boat is the boat of realizing everything is apex. It's all straight from the source right now. Nothing is interfering with it. Nothing is interfering with it. There's no graduated steps to the presentation of the play of reality. There's no graduated steps at all. Everything is happening in the now. Directly, directly. That's the apex realization. So this started, apex yoga started. What I'm doing here and what we are doing as each one finds their role and niche is pioneering a new yoga, actually. It's apex yoga. It's a new yogic approach sponsored by Longchenpa, directly sponsored by Longchenpa and the apex array, which includes Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, Padmasambhava, and Manjushri, and the Dharma Kings in full support of this, which is Sri Sri Nandamai Ma and Jesus Christ and Ramana Maharshi, adding them to the other four I mentioned previously. So it started February 13th, where I suddenly had this epiphany. I said, hey, I'm going to be an apex yogin. And I accept Longchamp. I accept your offer of this path that you want me to try out. And I'll give it a try. I'll give it a try. And so I committed to it. Later on, I found out that was his birthday. So I was like, wow, it was meant to be, huh? How does that work out? And so I committed, and then about 5 days later or so, 4 or 5 days later, I started practicing. Practice like the then Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, maybe mostly like Saturday, Sunday, Monday, sort of 3 days right in a row. I practiced, and then I took a day off, then I practiced again, then I kind of have been practicing every day, but some days more than others. But I did 3 days right off the bat, really intense to get the ball rolling. And then I found out, oh my gosh, this is really something. This is really something. It enables us to really get a very clear look at the mind. What's at play? The play of doubt, and how the mind is playing the play of doubt. But we just stay in our boat. We don't get out of the boat. We try not to get out of the boat. But the mind is so clever, you will find that it drifts you off. It is so cleverly, really. And you say, okay, another one, there's another one. And get back to it. So what is it, the 27th of February now? So it's been like 2 weeks, actually. It's been 2 weeks. Been 2 weeks already. Apex Yoga has been born, so to speak, emerged for 2 weeks, 2 week period already. And, I'm hanging in there. It hasn't been easy. These last 4 months have been quite difficult. But all months have been difficult as we go through the bumpy ride that is the world right now. The world's always a bumpy ride because all this doubt is always in play. It's always in play. We just are not aware of it. But once you start to see what's going on in the mind, you realize it's all in play. This is what's happening. But there's a secret to it. There's a big secret to it, which is what these Dharma kings are pointing to, turning our attention to. And there's a trick that we have used to trick ourselves, or at least pretend that we're tricking ourselves. We actually know what we've done, but we pretend it we're tricked by it. We imagine that there's a meditator that is producing all this doubt, that is imagining all this doubt, when in fact it's spirit that's imagining all this doubt. There's no intermediary at all doing this, but we imagine this sock puppet meditator thinking, when we and we think that that's the one that is doing all of this. And you will find out that conventional religion and conventional non-religion, etc., they all are operating under this false assumption. Whereas Apex Yoga recognizes that it's spirit that's doing all of this, and the so-called dreamer is just simultaneously being imagined along with the content, rest of the content of the dream. It's just part of the content of the dream that spirit's imagining simultaneously, and it's not doing anything. It's not doing anything. It's just like an inert puppet there that we presume that it's the one. It's like an image sitting in a meditational pose, and we're presuming that it's doing all this meditating, where it's not doing anything at all. This is what needs to be recognized, part of what needs to be recognized. And this is what the teachings really get at. The real teachings are helping us get to this. And once you see this, then the teachings start making sense. I had this book. I ordered this book off of eBay, I guess it was. Let me see what it's called. Buddha Mind, I think it's called. Buddha Mind, an anthology of Longchen Rabjam's writings on Zagpa Chenpo. And it was quite an unusual situation. When I opened up the book, when I got it, it smelled terrible. I tried to read it, and the smell, this musty, horrible smell, was so terrible. I couldn't read it. Literally couldn't read it. I said, "Oh my gosh, this is horrible. What am I going to do?" Well, I put it in the Ziploc bag, and I zipped the bag shut and left it in my room because I didn't want the smell getting out in the room. And I realized, I said, "Well, I'm not meant to read this right now. That's why." So, a couple days ago, might have been yesterday, actually. Yesterday, I decided, for some reason, I said, I want to open up this book and see if it still smells bad, and maybe take a look at it." And so I opened up the Ziploc bag, took the book out, and it smells great. How is that possible? Because the bag was sealed. So how could it have lost its odor like that? It's not possible. So it's a miracle. It's a miracle that happened. And along with that, I'm able to understand what's being said in the book. Whereas before, I said, "This is beyond me. I don't understand what this is about." So somehow there was this odor the book was giving out saying, "You're not ready to understand this yet." And now it's saying, "You are ready to understand this." And the book smells fresh and wonderful. So this is a miracle. There's no way that the odor could have dissipated in a sealed Ziploc bag. It's just not possible. And it was every page. It's just, I said, what in? I couldn't place the odor either. It was just noxious. Noxious. I said, "I'll never be able to read this book because it smells so horrible like this." And now there's no hint of that odor at all. And I'm able to read it. That's another miracle. I'm starting to have all sorts of miracles now. The one with our roses blooming all year round, blooming in winter like that, all year round, was just amazing. Just amazing. Nobody else's roses were blooming. All sorts of miracles are happening right now. And so here we goes with another one. But I just say, okay, just let them happen. Let them happen. As many as we need, let them all happen. And ask and ye shall receive. Ask and ye shall receive. Getting help from a Christian friend. He's really a great coach. I mean, he's really, the kind of Christian you want to meet. The real deal. The real deal. Living it. And criticizing Christianity, he's very aware of those people. They say, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus," but they're not doing anything. They're not listening, not hearing, they're not obeying. They don't get it, which is true. But there are some real Christians around, just like as there are really in any religion. There's some that really get it and they really work at it. And when they talk, you listen. So I listen. I listen to what he says. Pay attention. And he said today, be, go and do. I mean, it's your doing. He says, first do this, and let your actions speak. And then maybe later you can talk about what's behind the actions and people are interested in it. But let your actions speak. And get after it. And so God wants me to start working, balancing my fitness out. I met someone today, said, "Hey, I'm working out now." I said, "Why? What's your goal?" He said, "Well, I need to feel balanced, like with in my overall balance in terms of my fitness." And I realized I'm out of balance with my fitness, and I need to start working the lower body. So there again, there's a perfect clue saying this is what your trouble is, which is true. And so started then, be do be go and do be go and do be go and do. Be, go, and do. Great workouts, great nutrition, great apex yoga. That's kind of our motto. We're not trying to put on a show of being spiritual here in terms of ignoring the world. So do your great workouts, do your great nutrition, and do your great apex yoga. That's what I'm example I'm trying to set. I'm not trying to be an ascetic or some super meditator or ascetic like that. I'm trying to kind of be balanced in it all. It's the spirit of the times, right? It's the spirit of the times. We're not trying to run counter to that. We're not trying to counter it. We're just trying to use it intelligently with the grace of God informing us of what's the best way to go about this? So I've got, I the workouts continue to improve, 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 improve. Fitness continues to improve. Awareness continues to improve. And everything is just gliding forward. The Lord is my shepherd. Psalm 23, check it out. I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leadeth me to lie down in green pastures and walk beside still waters. So when we put our attention on God, then God's got our attention, and there's reciprocation there, that somehow we get blessed. Somehow we get blessed. And this is the testimony throughout history. So we just have to live it here, right now. Now, I don't know how it's going to go. I really don't know how it's going to go. I don't know what my role is, exactly what my niche is, but it develops. You just have to follow guidance, your own guidance, step by step by step by step. Get yourself in better and better overall condition. Your fitness, your nutrition, and your apex yoga practicing are familiarity. Familiarity is decisive. It really is. So, but it's familiarity in really in taking it to heart. There's different amounts of familiarity, how you do it. You can go fast or you can go slow, but you don't want to go too slow. You don't want to go too fast, and you don't want to go too slow. But you want to stay relentless in terms of steady determination every day. It's that relentless everydayness that is so successful. And you keep getting further and further and further and further and further. You notice more and more and more and more of the play of doubt, and you just say, well, that's silly, that's just a ridiculous little stratagem, that's not true. And you become less interested in it. When you see this stuff, you start losing interest in it. And as I've always said, enlightenment really is just you lose interest in doubt. That's all it is. You just lose interest in it. You just say, ah, time to set it down for a while. We'll see about it later on if I'm still interested in it later on. But right now, I'm not interested in doubt for right now. And then that's it. You set it aside. That's how I look at it. I'm not looking for the Big Bang, so to speak, or anything. I just lose interest in it. That's all. And the times that I've had breakthroughs, it's times when I felt very strongly, like, you know what, I'm just not interested in doubt anymore for right now. And I just, my attention just like effortlessly just seemed to then be on what we would call enlightenment, the seeing reality, actually being aware of reality. It was just that simple. There was no, nothing else other than I just decided, I'm going to shift my interest over here because doubt's just not really, doesn't have it have the pull that it used to have for me. I'm just not really that interested in it. That's all that it was. And so when someone asks, well, how do you do this? Yeah, that's it. For me, that's it. It's just the interest is the whole key to it all. As long as we stay interested in doubt, we won't see reality as it is, which is certainty. We won't. But when we really start to lose interest in doubt, we will start glimpsing reality. We'll take little breaks from doubt. Take a little break from doubt. Jesus calls it the holy instant. It's just taking a little break from doubt. That's all. And this will happen to you, happen to anyone. It was you start losing interest in doubt, you will begin taking this holy instant, a glimpse of certainty. You'll feel the certainty. The certainty will dawn upon you, a little brief dawning, and you say, oh, of course. Certainty is certain. Hey, so what is this doubt? It's nothing, actually. It's just a little game that we're playing with no outcome at all. Just a little diversion, you might say, a little silly diversion that we're playing that doesn't go anywhere, doesn't do anything. If it's just shooting hoops, you know. That's about it. And There's no game really going on, no winning, no losing, nothing. Just out there, backyard shooting some hoops for a little while. Until we decide, that's enough of that. So we're hitting the ground running right here in California, right on time as we exit now this tremendous rainy season that we've been going through. And now we have entered upon a couple weeks, they're saying probably a couple weeks of not really nice weather. Really nice. It doesn't seem to be any rain in the forecast at this time. And it seems to be, like spring-like weather coming our way, which, it's kind of like we're turning the corner here very quickly. This can happen very quickly in California. And I realized that, so I jumped on it. I really jumped on it. And I said, I don't want to get behind on this, and I want to hit the ground running here. So I'm full blast into the spring mode right now. I'm really right in step with it all, which is it's amazing. But because we've had so much rainy weather that I think we're like kind of dazed by it all. But no, California can turn beautiful in an instant, actually. It's kind of just like losing interest in doubt. Your attitude can turn beautiful in an instant, actually. In an instant, it can. And California, you might have super rainy days for a long time, like we have this winter, and yet today, when the clouds clear up, it's just this gorgeous day. You say, "Oh my gosh, how is that possible?" That's what happens here. It just, any day can just be just absolutely gorgeous. So lose interest in doubt, gorgeous attitude arises. Just like that. So quick. There's not all these graduated stages. My experience, I went just directly into it. It was just from one moment, I was just normal, like depressed and despair and full of doubt and just saying that life's horrible, I hate it, it's so struggling. And then I just decided, you know what? I'm just not so interested in this whole play of doubt anymore. And I wanna try just dropping that for a while. And just like that, it was all gone. I wasn't experiencing doubt anymore. It was just like that. I didn't do anything except I just said, let me just drop my interest for a little while. That is it. And for me, again, that's all there is to it. That's all there is to it. It's all make-believe. It's all sustained by our interest in it and nothing else. But our interest in it, when we try to drop it, familiarity problem kicks in, right? And we say, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, wait a minute. I'm not familiar with certainty here. Let's back off a little bit." And can we mix it and be both certain and uncertain and doubtful? No, you can't mix it. You cannot mix it. This is one of the key messages, like Jesus in A Course in Miracles, which is sort of like a very interesting. I draw a parallel between Buddha and Padmasambhava coming into the world, and then Jesus with the New Testament, and then now with A Course in Miracles. It's like a super, super upgrade kind of situation. Whereas Padmasambhava is said to have given a super upgrade for a Buddhism. He went into the inner teachings, the tantric or inner teachings, instead of the outer sutra teachings of Buddha. And it got pretty esoteric, apparently. I'm not into the esotericness about it all. The winds and the energies, the inner currents, energy currents, and how to undo the knots at the chakras and Anattara yoga. I've never been into that at all. But that's not all that Padmasambhava taught, actually. He also taught Dzogchen, which is what we're interested in here. And yet Apex Yoga is sort of like a streamlining of Dzogchen. It's kind of a combination of A Course in Miracles and Dzogchen and a streamlining of both of them into just a super simple approach. We just lose interest in doubt. That's all there is to it. There's nothing else to it other than that. And through this practice, I am an Apex Yogin. Wow. We just keep saying that, and we see then the play of the mind as it tries to incorporate what we're saying, We say, no, I won't be incorporated. And then it gets highlighted. We see it quite clearly. Oh my gosh. And seeing it, we see how stupid, how silly it is. And we start really losing interest in this entire play of doubt, really losing interest in it. So every bit of practice that we do, it is really designed to lose interest in the doubt and to familiarize ourselves towards certainty. Towards certainty. It's really that simple. So we don't have the esoteric component here of Tibetan Buddhism. We don't have that here at all. So it's just like incredibly simple here. Which for some who are battling doubts through trying to reach attainments, they won't go for that. But battling doubts through attainment is still delusion. It's the heart of delusion. That doesn't work at all. Doesn't work at all. There's nothing to triumph over. The observer and the observed are the same in essence, and are arising simultaneously as the play of doubt. Okay. It's really presumed doubt. If there's a presumption that the observer is perceiving something, but perception really is just a dream of spirit. Spirit is dreaming the whole notion of perception to cast doubt upon it, upon true experiencing. But it's the dream that's doing, the dreamer is the one who's dreaming of perception. It's the body isn't perceiving. Okay, it's the mind that's pretending to perceive. And the meditator isn't perceiving. It's the mind that's pretending that perception is taking happening, that something is perceiving an object, where in truth that's really not taking place at all. It's really not taking place. That's the delusion. The so-called perceiver and the perception and the object of perception is all arising as one, directly arising as one in pure spaciousness. And there's no, and it's vividly apparent within that pure spacious, not vividly apparent as a subject object perception, but as presence, as intrinsic presence, ornamentation of pure spaciousness. It's vividly apparent as that, just as that, as experience to spirit, direct experience. It's direct experience. It's not actually perception at all. So ultimately, you could say that there is no perception taking place at all. So this is a streamlining of A Course in Miracles and Dzogchen into what we call apex yoga. Apex yoga. A new yoga has been born. Apex yoga. It's tremendous. It's just tremendous. But we need it. We need it. We need it. There's a We're at a log jam in the world right now. A log jam has happened where the dance of protagonist and antagonist is very delicate dance, and the apple cart needs to be overturned to help everyone move beyond this. Obviously, we're at loggerheads, right? So we just, you don't work that out at the level that it arises on. You shift into a whole different paradigm, and you leave that old paradigm behind entirely, really. And that's what has to take place. So we have to upset the apple cart. And don't harbor doubts about doing so. It's no time to harbor doubts or regrets right now. It is no time for that. So we'll see if I, you know, I've spoken up so forcefully throughout my life. I'm an apple cart upsetter between the protagonist and antagonist, which is a very delicate dance. They need one another. They need one another. See, this is the thing. It's a kind of a balance. There's a codependency. And so we politically we have these protagonists right now, and they need each other. It's a dance, and so this needs to be upset. Actually, we need to upset that apple cart. But of course, they'll hate you for it. Jesus upset the apple cart 2,000 years ago, big time. He really did, and they crucified him for it. You know, they were so angry at him for doing this. But he said, this is what needs to be done to move forward. We have to move forward. So we're at another crucial point in history where the apple cart needs to be upset. It needs to be tipped over. And people might hate that. They might really hate it. So we'll see how that goes. We'll see how it goes. Because the world has really set me free and given me carte blanche and says, do what you need to do. It's okay with us. We understand. At some level, it's understood at some level. And at this point, we don't need to be crucified. That's not something I'm aiming for at all, actually. It's no time to harbor doubts. It's the right thing to do. And initially, the lack of, you know, that old dance of antagonist and protagonist, not having that anymore, seems like, oh my gosh, I'm so scared, I'm angry, I'm fearful. You know, if you don't have someone to hate, you know, it's like, and you're a hater, you know, what do you do? What do you do? It's scary, right? Well, you hate the one that upset the apple cart there. And that's what Jesus kind of did. They said, well, they'll hate me. That's okay. That's okay. And Sri Sri Anandamayi always said, look, if you're going to be angry with me. Don't be angry with anyone else. Just be angry with me. That's what she told people. So sometimes I've used that. You know, I start feeling angry with someone, I say, no, okay, let me get angry with her. I call her my little sister, my little unstoried sister. Unstoried sister, my little unstoried sister. She has no stories at all, no pasts at all. Path-free, story-free, little sister. What a great little sister to have, really. And she's everyone's little sister, actually, if you can see it that way. You know, just an absolute, you can't even say anything about it. One who has never had any path or any story to them whatsoever and is completely, inherently free of all of that. Always has been. And she came here and she said, I'm your little sister. I'm your little sister. That's how I want you to see me, as your little sister. How about that? So I took her up on it. I said, okay, you're my little sister. I accept that. She didn't come here just to say that and then not mean it, you know? That would be absurd. Just because someone's unstoried, no path, that doesn't equate to absurdity. You know, it equates to perfect certainty. So we don't know what our little sister will do, really. It's just no way to figure upon it, to figure it out. There just really isn't. I have never been able to ascertain really what she's going to do. But she continues to do the right thing at the right moment. Just because, you know, right? Compassion. Our great friend, Rama Maharshi, our great brother, Jamyan Genti Choki Lodro, right? The great Lama, omniscient Dharma King, Longchenpa, the great Savior, Jesus Christ, the great innovator, exemplar, Padmasambhava, and the great beauty, the gorgeous beauty, the sublime, gorgeous beauty, gentle glory of Manjushri. You know, these are our allies in Apex Yoga. These are our allies. These are the ones helping us out. And the impasse now in this world is such that, you know, it's gnawing on people, which is great. It should. It's time to take another leap, right? It's time to take another leap. And that's what we're doing here. Very simple, very streamlined. We're the nomenclature is getting much clearer. And it's so simple. It's so simple, actually. It really is. Super simple. But we're so addicted to doubt, which is based on the notion of complication and confusion and complexity, that simplicity seems to freak us out. We say, well, I got to make that more difficult. Which is why I don't like talking about this to people socially, because they never can accept it as on the level that it's presented as simplicity. They always have to make it more complex and confusing for themselves. So why? Because they're familiar with that. That's called the familiarity problem, the bias against certainty and simplicity. And this is universally, this is the reaction. Rarely do you get someone who just accepts it as it's said and just wow. But that's what you're looking for, is just wow. The simplicity wows us. It shocks us. It shocks us. It really is this simple. It is so simple. And that invariably will cause a great shock to us. Because you say, whoa, 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 I'm used to complexity. Wait a minute. So it's such a difficult path to get from complexity to simplicity. And yet, that's a path everyone has to take. Everyone has to take that path. There's no other way. Truth is completely simple. It just is. There's no complexity or complications to it whatsoever. And so this dream of doubt that we've been using to try to cast doubt upon ourselves and thereby God, since we're an idea in the mind of God, hoping that we can be greater than God by bringing God into God's supremacy as prime creator into doubt, and therefore thinking, well, it's open for competition. This familiarity with this dream of doubt is the problem. That's it. So we say familiarity is the problem, and then the fear that arises about broaching, you know, going into unfamiliar territory, we call continuity fear. That fear that arises, just continuity fear. But our bias, familiarity bias, really is severely in play in all of us. It's severely in play. So we have to, in Christianity they say, you're a sinner. That's exactly right. It's severely in play. Our bias is severely in play here. And by recognizing it and saying, yeah, I'm a sinner, then you can start working on the problem. You realize you have a problem, then you can start working on it. The Ninevites, back in the Old Testament times, Jonah came to the Ninevites, said, God, you know, you're going to have trouble in 40 days' time. If you don't repent, you're going to be wiped out. And all the people, everyone in the city repented. The king repented, took off his robes, put on sackcloth and sat in the dust and said, nobody eats or drinks, animals, people, nothing. And we're just going to pray to God for mercy, you know. And the city was spared. The city was, nothing happened. Of course, they were really drawing destruction down upon their own heads based on their, you know, desire to cast doubt upon God. And then they repented and said, wow, we have a severe problem and we need to work on it. Okay, it's not, and that's what it takes. So, everyone in the world should bow their heads and realize they have a very severe problem, because this is a fact, and people don't want, some people may not want to hear that, but this is the message that has to be presented. Everybody here has a very severe problem. I need to bow their heads and repent and realize I have to work on this. And I can't just project it on someone else and think that's the answer. Because that is, A Course in Miracles really brought this up, saying that what we do is we project this problem onto others and then feel that they're trying to attack us, because the projections still feel like they're coming back at us, you know, somehow. We didn't quite get rid of them, but we think we did, but they're coming back from someone else now, and they're trying to push this malignancy upon us. And so we feel that they're attacking us, and then we feel justified in attacking them. So projection really leads to violence, to war, to all sorts of hostility, etc. And so when you repent, you realize I'm the one with the problem, and everybody else has the same problem too. But the way I have to work on becoming familiar with certainty myself. I can't just expect someone to do it for me or get rid of it by projecting it on someone. That's called the mood of repentance. And then so you need to live within this mood of repentance. Everybody has to. And if people aren't, you still have to. You see, there's no excuses. We might say the world right now is so unrepentant. You'd say, well, I shouldn't have to do it then. No. That's that's all wrong. Doesn't matter. You have a problem, you have to work on it. Each one of us has to face that fact that we're very biased against certainty. And this is what is causing us to remain in this really hellish play of doubt. I mean, doubting what we are is mental conflict. Doubting what we are is mental conflict. There's no way around that. No way around that. And how do we get free of mental conflict? Stop doubting what we are. And how do we do that? Lose interest in it. And how do we do that? gain interest in truth and reality and certainty, get more and more familiar with that, which is natural to us. Gain more and more familiarity with that, and as we do that, the balance begins to shift in our favor of certainty, and we become less and less interested in the silliness of doubt. You might even stop watching television. Yeah, really, seriously, that's a miracle, isn't it? I stopped a lot of stuff in my life. I've just stopped. I'm not interested in it anymore, like baseball. I was the biggest baseball addict you're ever going to find. But I don't pay attention to it anymore. Sports, I don't pay attention to sports anymore. Again, I was just a sports fanatic. It's not that I hate it. It's just I'm just not interested anymore. The interest is just not there anymore. And on and on and on and on and on. This is what actually will happen. Is you don't turn into a hater. You just gently ease away from your interest in it as you find much more compelling focus for your attention. Like, wow, I could be free of death. Now I had an amazing experience today. It's been an amazing day, where I suddenly realized that we can actually, since all of this, all of conditioned existence, everything we've gone through is just nothing but a dream, we can literally change the entire dream so that nothing ever happened to us in terms of the dream. Like all your deaths that you've had through many lives, you can change all of that so that you never died in the dream. And all the sickness you have, you can just literally change it in an instant where you never got sick in the dream. And all the aging, you never aged, you never got sick, you never died, you never suffered, you never had any trouble at all. You can literally just be totally revisionist. There's nothing stopping us from doing that, because it was all make-believe in the first place. So we can just make believe that I never suffered any of those deaths. You might call this resurrection from the dead, but it's a spiritual resurrection from the dead. And we can experience all of this right now. So all regrets can vanish instantly, actually. So we can literally say nothing ever happened to us at all. That the dream was a dream of just this vibrantly happy, peaceful, blissful presence. That's the fluidity of a dream, isn't it? I've never even thought of this before. It just dawned upon me just a couple hours ago, really. It was so amazing. I just said, wow, 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 wow. What indeed is there to stop us from imagining this? Since all deaths are just imaginary in the first place, just imagine they never happened. And it's as if they never did happen. The effects, none of the effects will be present at all. Talk about getting rid of karma. we can get rid of all karma instantly, actually, in this way. So, talk about fruits of the Spirit, having this insight today. I didn't expect that. You know, actually, when I was working today, I felt super ripe. I told the Dharma Kings, I am super, super ripe right now. I really feel, I said, I know something great is going to happen today. And this insight may have been what was really great. I've never read this or heard this or anything like this before. And it just dawned, and I saw it right away. I said, hey, piece of cake. Of course we can do that. Wow. That's really astonishing, right? It's amazing. It's so simple. Once you see it, it's of course. And sometimes in your dreams, like you might do something, have a dream, and then you just decide, no, I didn't like that outcome. And you just undo it. Like it never happened. Like it never happened. That's why Jesus said, Lazarus, get up. And Lazarus said, oh, yeah, I lost interest in dying, so I'll just undo my death. And get up, walk out of the grave. It's that simple. It's that simple, actually. We're looking for other answers, but it's completely simple. It's all a dream. A dream death is not a real death at all. And so you can just decide that instead of that lifetime that you died, now you, that lifetime, you didn't die. You never died. And you can do that with all your lifetimes, and then you say, wait a minute, I've never died at all. That's, and you can say, that's actually how I want the dream to go. That other stuff was just, I was just playing around, and I decided I didn't really like that type of dreaming, so I'm just going to say, this is how I want the dream to be. And the other stuff, it's like it never happened at all. So this is a huge apex yoga breakthrough, and I'm just going to, you know, wow it for a while and not try to, you know, jump on it too much. Just let it marinate. I've got ice on my knee. I'm marinating my knee in ice right now, because I want to make sure after, you know, putting the knee under stress to ice it, to keep the swelling down, to minimize the swelling, which helps. Pitchers ice their arms after, baseball pitchers after their pitch, and you keep the swelling down. That's pretty much standard procedure. A lot of athletes ice after exertion, and I find that it's useful. It's not a panacea, but it's useful. But my knee's pretty cold right now. It's been almost an hour with the tight ice on my knee. Some of these athletes, they get in these ice baths after whatever their exertions. They literally immerse themselves in ice baths for who knows 20 minutes. I don't know how long they do it, but man, I mean, you talk about grit. I mean, but it helps them. Immerse them in ice bath, and all the swelling is kept down. Then they might take anti-inflammatories or do something, and then they eat right nutrition, and they really take great care of their bodies this way too, and it must have, you know, some positive effect. I don't know, an ice bath seems like a little bit severe, but I guess if they're paying you, if it's a difference between a contract of $20 million and $2 million, you'd probably get in the ice bath. I think I might do that actually. Another help is get enough sleep, which I am not getting enough sleep. My sleep schedule is messed up severely. I'm waking up like at 1:30 in the morning, 2 o'clock, and that's it. And then I start trying to practice the apex yoga. I just can't, you know, just so messed up because the flu messed it up. I was sleeping all day long, taking naps at all hours, and so my sleep schedule is just complete, doesn't know what to do, actually. But I feel okay. You know, you get some naps here and there, and this kind of it's been about 2 weeks since the flu first started. I probably caught it about 2 weeks ago, and it didn't really manifest for a couple days, but I started to notice some things, and so it's been 2 weeks, and starting to feel a lot better, and having to try and get back that coordination and balance and everything is, you know, sort of like coming out of a zombie-like state. You get the flu, you feel like a zombie, right? It's, fortunately, this one wasn't really bad. Very fortunate. Although some who got it said it was the worst they've ever gotten. So, but this one, the intensity must have calmed down by the time I got it. And so, seems like recovery is going well. It's not one of those, you know, 6 month sort of recoveries that we don't want that. Mentally, I can't handle 6 months. We're like just 3 months, 3 weeks away from spring here, and after spring comes summer, and we're gonna be in the summer of 17. I mean, you talk about the summer of 67, summer level. The summer of 17 is going to be something else. Okay, it's going to be something else. The projection and polarization, projection and dance of protagonist antagonist in order to try and fixate at this level, which really fixate tries to fixate on doubt, is very severe. Very, very is the most severe in history. Every wise person I speak with, from wherever, strangers, they all say, I think we're in the end times. I really, really, really believe we are. From every kind of background, it's amazing. They say it's just got to be. Everything's upside down and backwards, and this, you know, it's just it. We're here. We are here. And I feel the same way. We are really here. And so, summer of 2017. I don't know if it's going to be the summer of love. Might be the summer of hate, actually. Which is funny because the summer of love took place on Hate Street. In San Francisco. But it was spelled H-A-I-G-H-T, but it was pronounced Hate Street. Maybe there was a lot of hatred under the surface, you know? And it's surfacing now. I don't know. There's a lot of stuff that could be said about that. But 2017, summer of hate. So, we don't want to be focused on that. We want to tip over the apple cart here and have a completely different perspective, which is the apex yoga perspective. You could say I'm an apex yogin or I'm an apex yogini. You can say this, you know, if you want to. It's up to you. It's up to you. I just declared it for myself. I declared it, and then I was it. You know, I declared it, and I felt, wow, I just sort of passed this threshold, went across the Rubicon, and I'm in. Whatever niche arises for me, you know, it's a personal thing with each one of us. We're all unique in the roles that the grace of God gives us and such, but you can claim that for yourself. There's nothing stopping you from claiming I'm an apex yoga and I'm an apex yogini. Just I'm in, and this will be protect you from the summer of hate. It will really protect you. Because you will start being guided towards feeling like, you know, right now it's no time to harbor any doubts or regrets. So whatever we do, should it be up tipping over the apple carts of the world, that's okay. It's okay. There's no call to feel guilt about it. There isn't. There's no call to doubt yourself. You know, it's not the time to harbor doubts about taking right action like this and tipping over that apple cart and just messing up this dance of antagonist protagonist, just messing it up. Really, it's got to be messed up. It's got to be tipped over, the whole thing. Otherwise, it's going to be really, really bad. So, you know, we'll see how it gets tipped over. It's going to be tipped over one way or the other, right? I mean, things are getting really very, very interesting and intense. And I don't follow the news really at all. But it seeps in. People say stuff. You know, the little asides and stuff. And you just kind of gather from that. And also from, I'm, you know, very good at just feeling, intuitively feeling the overall mood of everything. And, you know, it's just like, wow. I mean, it's going to just be intense beyond belief, the summer of hate. And yet, there's a wild card. There's a choker in the deck, right? And this is how it works. And this delicate mating dance, you might call the protagonist and antagonist. They're both doing this dance, screaming at each other, and yet all the while they're trying to fixate doubt in themselves. You know, and using projection, thinking that they're you know, going to get somehow happy. They can have their doubt and be happy about it too. And then something comes along, and it just, you know, Jesus comes along and tips over the apple cart. You see, like in biblical times, John the Baptist and the Sadducees and Pharisees had this dance going on. Antagonist, protagonist. I mean, right? The protagonists were the Sadducees and Pharisees, and then the whole sacrificial Judaic Old Testament situation. And here comes John the Baptist saying, look, you know, you can be baptized and have your sins washed away. Come everyone. And so he went throughout the whole land there, and people were just flocking to him, you know. And so the Sadducees and Pharisees said, they were hated this. Herod, you know, said, wow. And who was it? His daughter, said to, he gave her a present. You know, she said, "I want the head of John the Baptist." And so he said, "Well, I got to keep my word," something like that. So the story goes. But I mean, John the Baptist was this antagonist throughout the countryside, but there was this balance going on between the Sadducees and the Pharisees and trance religion and John the Baptist. But then Jesus came along and tipped over the entire apple cart of it all. And that's what freaked them out. That's what freaked them out. So they said, "Wow," you know. They really said, "Wow, this let's both hate this guy. You know, this guy's crazy. That, and he's, you know, up tipping over the apple cart here, and our little dance isn't working anymore." So, yeah. I mean, historically, that's what happens. That's what happens. When we reach an impasse like this, historically, something happens, and it all shifts somehow. It all shifts. And so we're doing our little shift here. Apex yoga is this shift. You do this, you shift yourself. Yeah, I made a little shift February 13th. I said, "Okay, I'm ready for this." And simple little shift. I'm willing to lose interest in the world, the way this dance is going on, and let's shift into apex yoga. I'm an apex yogin. Wow. And that was it. Happy birthday, Lama Longchenpa. Lama Longchenpa. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday. And it just went like that. Very simple. So we are definitely in maybe the most interesting time of history right now. Most compelling. But it's compelling in how is it going to be tipped? You see? That's what's really interesting. Not this stupid polarity dance of, you know, both two different styles of let's kill truth, you know, let's kill certainty, and we have our way and you have your way. That's the dance that's really going on between the conservatives and liberals. That's, you know, each one screams, "We know how to kill truth, kill certainty," and the other side says, "No, we have the way to kill certainty. Your way won't work. Our way will work." And this is the dance they're doing, and yet then along comes certainty and says, "Guess what, boys and girls, you can't kill certainty." And then they say, "What? Yes, we can. Wait a minute. What are you talking about?" And that, you know, throws everything into a fine kettle of fish. I mean, it's just the dust arises sort of for a while. So it's very compelling in that way. And we're here for a reason. Every one of us is here for a reason. Okay? And hopefully you're tuning into this and you're saying, "Ha, wow. And you have all your players, you know, on the stage, your Barabbases and this and that, and they have different, you know, agendas, and they can use this and leverage here, blah, blah. Yeah, just all the same players are on the stage. It repeats, history repeats itself in this way. Judas and things like that. But that's all boring, actually. You know, so it's not going to be the same because we're bored with that. We're not interested in that anymore. It just doesn't interest anymore, that dance of doubt. So we're less interested in doubt now than we were before. Much less interested in it. So it's going to be something really great, like you can revise all your dreaming and have the dream simply be different, that you never died. You could even have the dream that you're never born. You could even dream that you were never born. And just instantly nullify all the dreams that you were born. You can actually do that. Any of us can. There's nothing stopping us at all from doing that. So there's all these gradualists, you know, religious gradualists and materialistic gradualists, and here we come and say there's no gradualism at all. And that, you know, both of them say, "What? Now we have our gradualism down pat, and we want to monopolize it, and we're just fighting over who's going to get to have the monopoly here in this world." And here we come and say there's no gradualism at all. It doesn't need to be. It can be instantly nullified, all of it. Instantly revised, all of it. in an instant. And so that tips over their apple cart. Which is really what they want. They're just pretending that they don't want it. So, it's a great time. It's a great time to be here. And so nobody lose heart, no lose hope, give up. Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And again, we're getting to it. Summer of 17, right? The summer of 17, we're called the summer of 17. So contemplate it, and who knows? At some point, you might just suddenly one morning you'll get up and say, "I am an apex yogin," or "Wow," or "I am an apex yogini." Wow, 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 wow. And that'll be like a new birth for you, actually. But it's very simple. It's very simple. You realize I'm not the same as I was before. I revised the dream. I've revised the dream. And now in the dream, I'm an apex yogin or yogini. I've revised the dream. And I can make it the dream such that I was always this way. I've always been an apex yogin or yogini. I've always been. And then all your karma vanishes. Gone. And what would that be like? I don't know. But it's certainly very compelling, isn't it, to consider this. And then, of course, we have our little sister who has no stories, no past at all to her. Talk about a wild card. It's always helpful for us to remember this, remember her, because this is really, really a wild card. She's a super wild card, super duper wild card, and really nobody even knows what she's going to do, and even she doesn't know what she's going to do. It's all spontaneous. See, there's no storylines for her. She's unstoried, unpathed, unstoried. So I've always emphasized, don't leave this one out, the one that we called Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Don't leave her out of your spiritual picture. Where she fits in is impossible to say, really, except she has, see her as your little sister. Your little sister. I don't know, like an 8-year-old, 6-year-old, 8-year-old, just a little, your little sister. Just imagine it that way. And make room for her in your heart. Make room for her in your heart. Very important. I try to do that every day in some way. It just seems to happen that my attention turns there for a while and just say, wow, you know, really happy that you're in my family. You know, I'm really thrilled I have a little sister like this. Really, really thrilled. Wow, how blessed I am. You know, how absolutely blessed I am. Permanently. She's a permanent part of your family. Permanently. She'll always be there as your little sister. And just sort of let this dawn on you. Marinate in that fact. And the same with Ramaharshi, this friend. You have this beautiful friend. This beautiful friend. They'll always be your friend. Like that. And these are moments where you're just speechless, you know, there's nothing to say. You just feel it. And you just sort of feel how blessed you are, actually. How absolutely amazing it all is. That this is actually, you're experiencing this. Again, you don't try to label it, really. It's beyond labels, beyond words. And again, because we struggle with that, I say just use wow. This is the word we use. It's the catch-all phrase. It's just wow. It's so wow. It's just so wow. That's it. It's just wow. And it's just 360-degree wild. It just smooths everything out for you. It just smooths everything out for you. And that's all you have to do. Just practice like that. Don't plan, don't anticipate, don't think what are they going to do, how's it all going to happen. Just feel blessed. And get used to that, used to feeling blessed, because of whatever they're going to do, it's going to make you feel even more blessed. They never make you feel less blessed. Grace always makes you feel more blessed. So, get used to feeling blessed and just wowing it. This is a blessing. All of this is a blessing. The play of grace is just a total blessing. Even all the antagonism is the play of grace. Even those who hate truth, that's still the play of grace. It's amazing. It's all the play of grace, everything here. Because as they try to get super talented at hating truth, all those super talents at some point flips and becomes in the service of loving truth. That's how it works. So nobody can get away from grace, actually. Even though they're fighting against it, that very fight against it is grace. It is. Because they become so dedicated to fighting, at some point that dedication swivels, and now one becomes dedicated to grace. And there's all that strength there that was built up in antagonism to grace. So grace can't lose. We can't lose. Because we are grace, actually. We can't lose. We cannot lose. It's impossible to lose. I am an apex yogin. Wow. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. Very pioneering. Here on the West Coast, California is that, you know, California was settled by pioneers, as America was settled by pioneers in terms of the new settlers that came along. And of course, the ones that reached California, the ones that just kept pushing across the country, and it wasn't easy, to say the least. I mean, you pushed away from the eastern seaboard, Appalachians, and you pushed past the Appalachians into what's become known as the Midwest, and then they pushed into the prairie land, and then you had this really huge area, starting with the Rocky Mountains, which was, you know, the West, and those who pushed into the Rocky Mountains and further were really very, very adventurous pioneers. Because that was tough country. And the high mountains and the deserts and the barren areas. And finally, you know, making all the Sierra Mountains into California. It was like, oh my gosh. And the Pacific Ocean, you know, they pushed all the way. And at that point, they realized that that's as far as we can go here. Yeah, and so, very hardy, rugged pioneer types settled into California. The 49ers, the people seeking gold from all over the world, these were people who abandoned everything. They abandoned their families, their jobs, their country, their culture, everything, and just came to this unknown place called this California, Sierra Nevada, San Francisco, Central Valley, Sierra Nevada, and looking for treasure. They were treasure hunters that came here. And that's an external expression of an inner desire to find the inner treasure of truth. And so they had this quest here, like we're going to find the mother lode. We're going to find the great treasure. Somewhere there's a great treasure. Well, it's really within us, which is certainty. But that spirit here, you know, is still permeated this area to the extent that you feel here that you can find a great treasure. My feeling here was the same. I'm going to find a great treasure here. There's no question about it. Because so many that came here because of that. Also because they thought they'd come here, they'd recover their health and you'd have perfect health out here. That was sold a lot throughout the country. The idea that there was, you know, gold dust in the air, the air out there was just, you just get cured by breathing the air out here. It was just, there's this great hope in California, throughout the world, actually. And so that permeated California when I was, you know, came here in 1956. The history of California is permeated by this tremendous optimism that we're going to find, you know, nirvana here, paradise here. So I grew up and always feeling that I'm going to find this great treasure, and I'm finding it. But it's within us. As my dad told me, he says, look, after searching the world, he came back and said, no, it's within. Search within. That's where you'll find it. But we're very pioneering and very adventurous here, at least my generation, maybe, you know, some of us. So I'm of that type who's willing to pioneer a new yoga, apex yoga. I'm willing to do it. I say, you know, let's do it. Because you will find the mother lode that way, no doubt about it. You will find it. It's already here. It's actually inescapable. It's just we have to lose interest and doubt, and voila, there it is. There it is. Just like that. But losing interest and doubt, well, that takes a lot of willingness, a lot of focus, a lot of determination, maybe a lot of desperation, actually. But if we're not desperate right now, with the way the world's going, we're certainly going to be desperate pretty soon, right? So it's a good time to be desperate. It's a great time to be desperate. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with desperation. I feel it all the time. And you buckle down and say, okay, let me break through this wall of procrastination. And so desperation's your friend. It's your ally. Really, it's fantastic what it can do. We just say, okay, I gotta get with this, get doing this. It has to happen now, not tomorrow. And you break the ice. You break the ice and you go for it. And that's what it's all about right now. So just stay with it. And who knows, in an instant, you might suddenly, your interest and doubt drops to the extent that you make the shift. I'm an apex yogin. I'm an apex yogini. That's it. Done deal. And then how it goes, I don't know. I can't tell anybody how it's going to go for them, right? It's just. But you're a pioneer. And you'll find your way. You'll find your niche. It'll happen some way. You'll have a path. And it's a great thing to have a path right now like that. This protects you from this ridiculous polarity, projection, hatred dance, which is two sides of the same coin of trying to kill certainty. You know, it protects you. Protects us from this. And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for refuge. I asked for help. The great Lama, the great Dharma King, Longchenpa, showed up. And his advice is to take refuge right now. Okay. Now, so we're working on that. What does it mean? Well, spiritual refuge for sure, right? Take refuge in this path, so to speak. Yeah. And who knows what other... What will accompany this refuge, but it will happen one way or the other. It will happen, but we have to do our part and really bust through the walls of procrastination and say, you know what, I can't wait around and wait to see what it's going to be like. You know, I've been warning people for so long. I say, don't wait to find out what it's going to be like. The whole purpose of a prophet is to warn people ahead of time so they don't wait. So they prepare ahead of time. That's the whole purpose of it. So if you just wait until to see how bad it gets, then you realize, oh my gosh, it's terrible. Well, you haven't prepared, right? And so you're in big trouble then. So just anticipate. I saw a guy today. This is amazing. It's sunny. It's beautiful. And this guy is in a full, what do you call it? I call it Mac full Macintosh suit, rain, bad weather suit, black Macintosh suit is unbelievable. He's like some, you know, cowboy movie or something. The outlaw riding with this, you know, it was amazing. Black was like black leather from head to toe. He was dressed. He was ready for like, you know, Noah's deluge or something. It was amazing. I couldn't believe it. And the black hat, the black beard. I looked at this character. I said, "What are you doing? I mean, you're dressed like for the end of the world or something, in this Macintosh outfit." I'd never seen anything like it. And he's striding, he's standing there waiting for the light to turn. And everybody else is walking around. It's a beautiful sunny day. and then I said, "Hey, wait a minute. This is God telling me something. He's saying, you need to be prepared in the same way for what's to come. You need to start getting used to that full Macintosh outfit of protection." So here he is. He's getting used to this, okay? He's wearing it, even though it's sunny, because a rainy day is coming, right? A rainy day is coming, and we don't know how severe that rain could be. But when it comes, he's going to feel absolutely safe and comfortable and used to this full Macintosh outfit that he's wearing. And he's just going to be gliding around like it's nothing. Whereas the rest who are not doing this at all, they're going to be all fumbling and bumbling around. So it's God saying, get ready, even though it's a sunny day, get ready for the rain that is to fall. And the rain most certainly will fall. The rain of what? Hatred, I imagine, in the summer of 17 could be the summer of hatred. It's going to be a summer of toxic emotions, to say the least. We're going to have full protection. We're going to be used to being protected. We're going to be used to it. We're going to be familiar with it. And so we'll just stay in our gear. You know, we're all geared up, just like that guy in that Macintosh outfit. He's already geared up, but he's getting used to it. We're getting in our spiritual Macintosh outfit, so we're all used to it. So when the toxicity happens, that's water off a duck's back for us. So this is what's called being prepared ahead of time. Now, certainly people might say, "Well, you're being eccentric," which is why I don't really tell people I meet socially about it, because they say, "You're some crazy eccentric. What are you doing walking around in a Macintosh, full Mac, and it's a bright, hot, sunny day? Come on, that's ridiculous." But he's getting used to it. He's getting familiar with it. If you wait until the trouble strikes, you're not familiar. And then you're struggling with the problem of familiarity, which is decisive. Again, here, familiarity is decisive. So you do not want to wait until trouble comes, because then familiarity is working against you. And that will certainly trip you up. Certainly it will. So you have to be a little eccentric right now. You have to be a little eccentric, but keep it on the down low. You know, keep it on the down low. I should have taken a picture of this guy. It was absolutely fabulous. I've never seen such a cool Mac on anyone. All, you know, floor length, all the way to the ground, with the chaps on the shoulders. The whole thing was just like, what is this guy? A samurai or something? Dressed in leather? I mean, wow. It must have cost him a fortune. But what a style he had. What an eccentric style. We don't have to be that eccentric. We keep it on the down low. We might be spiritual eccentrics. Actually, we are. We're spiritual eccentrics. I'm sure people view me that way. So what is this guy pushing so hard, pushing on all this stuff for? What an eccentric. You know, things aren't that bad right now. Well, just wait till the summer of 17 and subsequent to that as it goes forward. As I've been barking about this for so long, we get familiar with taking refuge. We get familiar with it. And then familiarity is working for us. When the deluge comes, we have familiarity working for us. And that's decisive. You can't beat familiarity. Okay? You can't beat it. If you have it, you can't be beat in this world. You can't be beat. Whoever tries to dislodge you, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. You're like a guru. You're like heavyweight because you have familiarity. That's gaining. The heavyweight is gained through familiarity. And if you have it, all this feeble, flimsy, intellectual label stuff they throw at you, it's just water off a duck's back. It really is. They can say whatever they want to say, blah, 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 throw this name up, throw this label up to us. It's just like, you know, whatever. It's not getting through. Water off a duck's back. All right, super important, okay. So be a little eccentric in your preparation. And as I say, err on the side of caution. Err on the side of caution. And be prepared ahead of time. Be familiar with your gear, your spiritual gear. I am an apex yogin. Wow. Practice it. Do what you can to practice it. Get familiar with it, even if you're not good at it. I mean, it's rugged, but it's right. It may be a little rugged for you, but you know it's right. And so give it a whirl. Give it a try. Do your best. Get familiar. Don't expect the summer of 17 to be a cakewalk for anybody. It's not going to be a cakewalk. You know it isn't. You know it's not going to be a cakewalk for the world. There's no trend at all that indicates it will be. Okay. When the meteorologists say there's a huge Pineapple Express coming, you know, it's going to get clobbered, you know. Well, this winter, they were right. We got clobbered here in California. Bridges collapsing. I mean, there are parts of California that are cut off. Big Sur coastline. You can't go down Big Sur anymore. A bridge is basically buckled there. And there's no way through. It's the only way through. Now, there are places that are isolated, that are cut off. So we got clobbered. And the Pineapple Express of vitriol and toxicity and projection and hatred and fear and all this stuff, it's headed our way for the summer of 2017. It is really headed our way. Yeah, some people mentioned stuff's happened in the Bay Area. I don't want to repeat what's going on. I mean, they're scraping the bottom of the barrel here. You know, I mean, they're ramping up their hatred like never before, like never before. And so, again, don't expect it to be a pleasant summer unless you're prepared and have taken refuge. And then it's going to be fantastic. My summer 2017 is going to be absolutely fantastic. It's going to be so extraordinary. I can't even explain it. You know, I just know it will be. I know it will be. So I'm hopping on my trampoline and jogging in place on the trampoline and saying, you know what, I'm going to do this. I'm just going to do this for the next 3 weeks until, you know, spring comes and see how spry I feel when spring hits. And we'll just see. We'll see. But I'm willing to do it. Yeah, it's kind of boring. And it takes great mental determination to do it. But I say, you know what, got to go for it. Got to go for it here. We cannot wait and see how it plays out. That is the fool's gambit, okay? That's a fool's play to wait and see how it turns out. It's like someone where there's a flood, they say the river's likely to flood, the Pineapple Express is coming, the river's likely to flood, and the people say, well, we'll wait and see if it floods. I mean, who does that? Well, a lot of people in San Jose did that. You should be saying, you know what, I better put plywood up across windows, doors, sandbags. I better put sandbags up. I better take precautions here, because what they're telling me is going to flood, and you know what, it might. Let's not risk it. And a lot of people didn't prepare in San Jose, and there's really a historically terrible flood here. A lot of homes got ruined, a lot of possessions got ruined. You know, people are really, really hurting here across the whole state of California. A lot of people are hurting, and you know, same thing. You got to take precautions if you're told by those who are really expert at it that, you know, likely to be a flood. There's likely to be flooding. They told us likely to be flooding. Better prepare. And it was worse than they thought. It was a lot worse than they thought, actually. You know, black swan event, worst case scenario, but that's cropping up more and more and more. So I'm saying summer 2017. It's going to be very intense. It's probably going to be worse than we realize. Worse than we realize. But we can be part of tipping over the apple cart and be free of harboring doubts and regrets about doing so. Seriously. Seriously. When you're an apex yogin, you're not going to harbor doubt about what you're doing or regrets. It's something that has to be done. I'm sure Jesus doesn't regret what he did, right? He's not regretting it. It had to be done. It had to be done. It was the right thing to do, and we're thanking him for it now. More and more and more, we're thanking him for it. And those who tip over the apple carts, they have the thanks of the whole world for it, deep down. People may be surface, they may be all hostile and hateful, but deep down they're saying, wow, that's great. This is really helpful. Really, really, really helpful. Really helpful. All the Dharma kings have been super, super helpful for it. So we bow in homage to them with great gratitude for what they have done and what they are doing now and what they will do, which is amazing. Amazing grace. That's why they call it amazing grace. Okay. Well, it's an hour and a half here. That's good enough for this one, for this initial simulcast, and we'll just see if this audio is, you can hear it, or if it's too low, or if it's too much clipping, etc. But hopefully it turned out great. Okay, so very great. That's it for this one.